her then, if you had it.
Well, yeah.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
What a wonderful morning. It's a beautiful morning. The sun's outside and the sun's in here, too.
Yes, it is.
Hey, amen. We have a nice service plan today. We're going to be talking about how to read our Bibles. And we're going to be in Psalm 119, talking about the Word of God and the importance of it to get us through every trial and every tribulation that we go through here now. And so we're going to be looking at that, but we're going to start off with worship. We are going to start off with a song right now. So if we can stand together, let's start off with Only a God Like You. Here we go. Service, anoint the sermon and just touch the hearts of the people and help them grow and help them to learn about you, Lord, and help them to know the security that comes from having you in their life. We thank you so much, Lord, for this opportunity to serve, and we thank you for all that are here, and we ask for these things in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Here's one called a famous one. It goes like this.
Yeah.
Your holy presence. gives us breath. He loves us and we love him. Praise the Lord. Right now we have a scripture reading, and it goes like this.
Psalm 119, verses 121 through 128. I have done judgment and justice. Lead me not to mine oppressors. Be surety for thy servant for good. Let not the proud oppress me. My eyes fail for thy salvation and for the word of thy righteousness. Deal with thy servant according unto thy mercy, and teach me thy statutes. I am thy servant. Give me understanding, that I may know thy testimonies. It is time for thee, Lord, to work, for they have made void thy law. Therefore I love thy commandments above gold, yea, above fine gold. Therefore I esteem all thy precepts concerning all things to be right, and I hate every false way. Psalm 119, verses 121 through 128.
Praise the Lord. We're going to be talking about that psalm. Basically, that psalm is basically talking about the wonderfulness of the Word of God. And so we're going to pick some of the things out of there and look at the Word of God when we go into it. But we're going to sing one more song right now, and it's our time for giving. And we have our usher come forward today. Pray that you give with the whole heart. And we're going to do one more song called Bless the Lord, O My Soul. Here we go. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. your holy name. Lord is so good. Well, right now we are going to have a film for you right now before we switch over to the sermon. We used to do greeting, but we have something right now, and it's called the Bible Brainstorm. As we get ready to kind of open up our Bibles and think about it, I want you to see this video. Here we go.
I'm getting there.
All right, guys, listen up. We need something big, something huge. We need to figure out how to make the Bible more exciting to people.
That's right. That's why we brought you guys in to brainstorm. You are essentially our panel of experts.
Our go team. Our green berets. Our SEAL team 6.
And go. Moses, hit me.
I'm thinking large body of water.
Ooh, I like this.
This is already good. We get a bunch of people together. Just tons and tons of people together, right?
I feel like this sounds familiar.
And then, kaboom. I divide the water in half and I let everyone walk through. That is exciting.
You're welcome. Who's hungry for lunch? Should we do Chinese? I'm thinking Chinese.
Moses, it's been done before by you.
Peter, talk to me.
First off, what's up, Paulus, on cutting off people's ears, huh?
Gonna pretend I didn't hear that.
Who's next? Balaam, talk to me.
Well, I do know about this talking donkey. I mean, that's pretty cool, right? Talking donkey. I mean, no one's ever seen anything like that. I mean, like, ever.
Come on! Haven't you seen Shrek?
Hello, donkey!
Am I the puppy?
Guys, we need to bring out the big guns. This is the Word of God we're talking about. We need to show people how exciting it is, Moses. You saw God, right?
I saw the back of him.
No idea. You're gonna love this, all right? So we get this bush, right? And then, you know, everybody's walking around going, nothing crazy going on here, it's just a bush, huh? And then, kaboom! A huge fireball comes out of nowhere, and the bush is on fire.
Huh? Deja vu, Moses. Let's freshen that pot of idea coffee, shall we?
Lot, please tell me you got something.
I got nothing.
Well, how about your wife? What's she thinking? Tommy. I'm sorry. I did not mean to rub salt in your wound.
Really?
I'm sorry. I just want to put all this behind us and not look back.
Let's just get back on point. Joseph, any thoughts?
Dude, what if we give a free coat of colors to everyone who reads the Bible, huh?
Good thoughts. Could get a little expensive. Moses, is this an original idea?
Does it involve using manna? Does it?
Of course not.
Does it?
Next, King David.
Free rock slings for everyone.
Edgy, but I don't know if arming people is such a good idea. Kind of sends a conflicting message.
Oh, God. Is this a bad time to bring back the cutting off people's ear thing?
Yes.
You can't deny that my idea has potential.
Oh, you know a little something about denial, wouldn't you, Peter? Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you?
Okay, say we draw some water from a rock, and then... Moses, we need to have a talk.
Yeah, you need to be quiet. Yeah. Take a note from Lot's wife.
Pilot, you have anything good?
I'm out, Eddie! I'm done! Wash my hands of it! Real classy, Pilot. Good teamwork. Right? Well, that'll make it.
I'll bring you some bread and fish, Seth.
Oh, it's a little boy that gave his lunch to Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
We're good, kid. Thank you.
Yeah. Unless you got a good idea on how to make the Bible more exciting.
Yeah, you got anything for us?
Well, I was just thinking that I can't think of a more exciting book than the Bible. I mean, it's got action, adventure, and romance. And the greatest hero story in the history of literature. And on top of all that, it's the Word of God. God uses the Bible to actually communicate to us. What's more exciting than that? Oh, and one more thing. God bless us, everyone.
Oh, Miss Ida. Hey, are you the dudes who validate parking, or do I have to talk to somebody else?
All right. I thought that was kind of funny, anyway. Quite interesting, anyway. But we're talking about how to make the Bible come alive, and I want you to have your Bibles ready. We're going to be in Psalm 119. Today we're going to be looking at God's Word. What's that? Excuse the kids? Okay, kids. Sorry about that. I started right in. Children, excuse the children's church. Anyway, today we're going to be looking at God's Word and the authority of it, how to make it real in our heart. And we're going to be looking at the blessings and things, and we're going to be seeking Jesus' wisdom, just as if he was here, you know. And I was thinking about that literally. Have you ever thought about Jesus being here now? There was a thing I came across that says if Jesus were here now, somebody would consider that if Jesus was doing his ministry on earth, there would be some real situations he'd have to deal with. Like, first of all, he'd be wanted by the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, for turning water into wine, wouldn't he, you know, without a license. He would be wanted by the APA for killing fig trees, that's the Environment Protection Agency. He would be wanted by the AMA for practicing medicine without a license. The Department of Health for asking people to open the graves up, for raising the dead, and for beating 5,000 people in the wilderness. He'd be wanted by the NEA, the National Education System, for teaching without a certificate. He would be wanted by OSHA for walking on the water without a life jacket and flying without a certified airplane. He'd be wanted by SPCA for driving hogs into the sea. The National Board of Psychiatrists for giving people advice for living a guilt-free life. He'd be wanted by the NOW organization for not choosing a woman apostle. By the Abortion Rights League for saying whoever harms children would be better if they would have never been born. And finally, the Interfaith Movement for condemning all other religions. You know, there's two religions. There's the right one and all the others, isn't there? Being born again and those who aren't born again. We know that man has his laws and not everybody likes him, but God has his laws and lots of people don't like those laws, and we see that all the time. But God requires obedience to his word, as we are going to see right now how to make our Bibles come alive so we can strengthen our spiritual life. Let's go ahead and go to God in prayer before we start. We have a couple prayer requests. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come together with the people and discuss your word, Lord. And I pray that you anoint the message and touch the hearts of everybody. And Lord, I just pray that you would just hear our prayer about others right now. And we have a request to pray for Connie's uncle, Dean, who is passing away right now. He's had cancer for some time and they were only giving him like a couple weeks left. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would just comfort him and help him to know the truth, Lord. And I hope that there's somebody there to tell him and encourage him with the words of the gospel, Lord, to help him have reassurance in his life. Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to pray for him, though. But also, Lord, I want to pray for this message and this church. Lord, I pray that you would just change their hearts and help them to be on fire for you, Lord. I pray that with the messages that they would want to share it with others and they would want to grow in their faith and they would be able to see the world with different eyes and see what's going on. The Bible gives us so many things to understand, Lord, about the future, and I pray that you would help them to understand these things too. But we know we need to learn the word. We thank you again, Lord, for this opportunity. We turn it over to you right now, and I pray that you would open their eyes and ears and minds and hearts up so that they would receive a message. And I thank you again, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How to make your Bible come alive. Well, if you do not know or understand or love or practice or obey the Word of God, I can tell you without any stutter or stammer that or apology that you are not a victorious Christian. We want to learn today how to study the Bible and how to make your Bible come aflame and make it just burst alive in your hand. And now what we're going to say today is going to be taken from this wonderful Psalm of 119. You know, knowledge is power in any realm, and whether it be in business realm or athletics or in theology, knowledge is power. And if you'll have knowledge in good things, you'll do good powerfully. And if you have knowledge in bad things, you'll be a powerfully wicked person. Now, what we want to do today is we want to get the knowledge from the Word of God and put that in our head and in our heart. And so, because what people need today is what we call truth. I want to read to you a prayer from someone in Kenya, and here's the prayer. Lord, from the cowardliness that dares not face the truth, from the laziness that is contented with half-truths, and from the arrogance which thinks it has all truth, good Lord, deliver me. Amen. Now, I hope you also this morning do not have the cowardliness where you are afraid of the truth, or that you'll not have laziness and accept only half-truths, and that you will not have arrogance that you think you need no truth, because, friends, it is knowledge and it is truth that transforms. Because that's it. There was a sign in a business that I went by one time, and it said this. It said, "We are not what we think we are." And I thought about that, and I thought, well, that's just showing humility, and that's kind of a sign of humility. But the Bible says something different. Scriptures say, we are what we think we are. And that means you are what you think. It's like in Proverbs 33:7, the Bible says, as a man thinketh, so he is. Now, if that is true, then knowledge is power. And we need the knowledge of the Word of God to have spiritual power. And we need to be molded and motivated and managed by the Word of God. Yet for many, the Bible remains a closed book, a mysterious book. And many give lip service to the Bible, but they don't understand it. And you know, there's no cheap way to understand the Bible. You have to start in and just dig. But it is not impossible. As a matter of fact, it is joying and it is thrilling. Once you get into it, it pulls you along learning about it. And so we want to talk to you today about how to understand the Word of God. This Psalm 119 is by far the very longest psalm in the Bible. And it is an acrostic. An acrostic is something that has an arrangement of letters. This acrostic starts with the Hebrew alphabet, and what it does, it's divided up into sections. It has two stanzas, and you wouldn't know it that it was an acrostic by just reading it in English, but each stanza starts with a Hebrew letter in the alphabet, and it goes through the 22 sections, as you can see them in there, and each verse in the 22 sections starts with the same letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Well, I know, wow, what a blessing that is to know that. But the thing is to think about, you should understand that there is a logical arrangement there. And the writer of the 119th Psalm is trying to give us some statements about the Word of God. The entire Psalm, you'll see, is there's so many verses, well, over 100 verses, and each of these verses is dealing with the Word of God. And it helps us to know and help us to understand the Word of God. Now, I want to tell you three things today to make your Bible come alive. And if you do these three things, I can promise you, and I prayed over this, and I thought about this, if you'll do these three things, the Bible will burst a flame in your heart and in your mind and in your life. So number one on your outline, hopefully you have an outline. Do you guys need an outline or anything? You're just right here. You can fiddle on and write and see how far along I am. Maybe Dendro will get you one or something. Would you do that? Thank you, Dendro. Number one on your outline, you must appreciate the virtues of the Word of God. Appreciate the virtues. Now, if you don't appreciate the virtues of the Word of God, you're not going to have any desire to learn it or to know it. Now, many people do not understand the great value and the great virtue of the Word of God, but to understand, you must have an appreciation for the Word of God. Do you love it? And why should you appreciate the Word of God? Well, on your outline, first, because it is a timeless book. It's timeless. I mean, look at Psalm 119:89. If you would get in your Psalms 119 and dig around in there with me, you'll find that most of these scriptures are just in this one Psalm, 119. I always put all the scriptures up on the board except for the one main scripture that we do. Are you trying to get in? Okay, there we go. Anyway, and so we're going to see here, looking in Psalm 119, we're going to look at verse 89 here to start with. And it says, "Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven." Another one says, "stands firm in heaven," which means this Bible is not the book of the month. It is not the book of the year. It is not the book of the ages. It is an unchanging book. It is the book of the ages. It is an unchanging book. Look at the thing at 152. It says, "Concerning thy testimonies, I have known of old that thou hast founded them forever." Forever, I've known it from old. Now, God only says it's done, it's settled in heaven, but I have founded it also forever. In Psalm 119, 160, it says, "Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever." Thy word is true from the beginning. You see, folks, other books come and go, but the Bible is here to stay because it is founded in heaven. You know, thousands of years have passed since the Bible was written. Empires have risen and fallen and gone from the scene. And civilizations have changed and rechanged. And constantly science is pushing back in the frontiers of knowledge. And yet the Bible stands. There were emperors who have decreed the extermination of the Bible. There are plenty of atheists that laugh at the Bible and they've railed at it. And there are agnostics who sincerely sneer at it. There are liberals who are moving heaven and earth to remove all the miracles from the Bible, like Thomas Jefferson wrote a book and took all the miracles out. And there are many materialists who simply ignore the Bible. They have no time for it and they don't revere it. But the Bible still stands, and it will stand forever. This is a promise from God. Then also there are radicals and cultists have taken it out of context and rave over it and preach out of it. And that's the way I know, the real way that I know the Bible is the Word of God, because it stood up to so much shoddy preaching. So many false religions don't believe that Jesus is God, that Jesus says He is God over and over and over and over again. You know, the late Greek Dr. Robert G. Lee said, speaking about the Bible, he said, "All of its enemies have not tore one hole in its holy vesture, nor stole one flower from its wonderful garden, nor diluted one drop of honey from its abundant hive, nor broken one string on its thousand-stringed harp, nor drowned one sweet word in infidel ink." And he's simply saying that what God says about himself is that this forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. Look what it says in the New Testament with Peter. Peter 1:25, you don't have to turn there, Don, we'll go up there, but it says, "But the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you." And there it is. It endures forever. The word is timeless. So you see, the Bible is ultimate. The Bible is indestructible, and you can't destroy it even if you tried. Many have tried, and they've all failed. And we're talking about the virtues of God. So remember, number one, we must appreciate. And under appreciating it, it is a timeless book. But also under it's a timeless book is on your outline. It is a truthful book. It is truthful book. Look what it says in Psalm 119, 142. It says, "Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is truth." This is righteousness that lasts forever, and the law is truth. Look what it says in 151. It says, "Thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are truth." Oh, let's read 160. It says, "Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever." Wow, thy word is true from the beginning, and his judgments and mercies endure forever. You know, Pilate asked Jesus, "What is truth?" And Jesus said in John 17:17, speaking of the Father, "Thy word is truth." That's what he said. So in a world that has lost its appreciation for truth, you can say without stutter or stammer that the Bible is truth, absolute truth. Now, we have some theological experts today who think that they ought to re-examine the Bible. As far as I'm concerned, we ought to re-examine them. Instead, I'm serious, you know, there are all kinds of attacks on the Bible today, and as the world goes on and as we go farther into the time of the tribulation, which we're not in yet, But when we get closer to these ending times, we see that the Bible is being attacked all over the place. And what they're attacking is those conservative values. There's all kinds of attacks and stuff. There's the frontal attack of a liberalism, and that's the liberals who deny it outright. We know where they're coming from. They just don't believe it, and they think it's all wrong. But then there's the attack from the rear, which is perhaps more insidious, where they talk about their experiences all the time. And they are always relying on rather than the word. And they have a healings they've had, or they've had visions, or they have some spiritual gift, and they can't seem to get beyond that. And sometimes it gets in the way of them really learning the word, and they don't realize that lacking knowledge that they are. And they're the ones that are saying, well, I don't know. That's what I feel. That's all I know. I know how I think and stuff. And sometimes I've been in arguments with them. I've had arguments with them, one about going to church and some different things. And after you argue with them for a little while, they end up saying, well, I don't care what the Bible says. Then, well, you don't care what the Bible says? Let me tell you what I know. I had an experience where the Lord told me, or this or that, and what I've been through, or what I've experienced is the most important thing. But it's not. It's the Word of God. Paul had a word to some of those in Corinth who had a problem with all their spiritual gifts. Look what it says in 1 Corinthians 14, 37 and 38. It says this, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. But if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. So Paul is writing and he's saying he speaks the commandments from the Lord. And now you see, they were some that were getting off there in Corinth, and they were getting in their hocus-pocus stuff, and they were getting wild in tongues, and then they got wild in prophecy, and they had visions, and they were in ecstasies, and Paul was trying to set them in order, and they were saying, well, let me tell you, Brother Paul, about my spiritual gift. I can't believe it. Let me tell you, Brother Paul, I think this is a gift of prophecy, or I have a gift of tongues, or I have a gift from a word from God and everything. And Paul says, well, that's fine. But you think you're a prophet, you think you're so spiritual, you will acknowledge that what I say is the word of God. Because all true gifts give testimony to the true word of God. And that's how you can tell if the gifts are from God or not. If it gives testimony to the word of God, you know it is true. Because don't forget, Satan does spiritual gifts too. But it has to line up with the Bible. We're supposed to have a discerning heart on looking out, seeking the Spirit. How can you tell if your gifts are from God? You have to know the word. Paul says for sure, what I say is the word of God. And then he said something humorous. He says, but if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. And he shrugged his shoulders. They had a lot of time with Jesus. People that would pursue Jesus. Jesus wanted to be pursued. They would have to pursue him or he would walk away too. He would offer them some information and stuff. But he wants to be pursued. And he shrugged his shoulders. Evidently, Paul had met some of those people that you and I are around today that are just unconvincible and they're stubborn. Therefore, there are people who want to bring the Bible under their experiences and make it fit them. And you see, there is the frontal attack on the Bible by those who rail against it and deny it, those liberals. And there is the attack from the rear by those who want to substitute their experience or their own understanding for the Word of God, like Pentecostals do a lot. But also then there's the attack at the flank from the side. And it's this, those that don't necessarily deny the Bible, but they just kind of want to kind of replace it and help it. They kind of want to prop it up with psychology and philosophy, with other things. And they try to look at the Bible and kind of put it with the world. And it's kind of what we think of as this secular approach to the Bible. And it's as if the Bible itself is not good enough. But friends, the Bible is true. If it's not good enough, you don't know it that well. And if you're looking for truth, you can find it in the Bible. Look what it says in 2 Timothy 3:16. It says this. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, and for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That's how important it is. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God. Now, that word inspiration is used only once in the Bible. And what a magnificent word it is. It's really in Greek, it's called theonestes. It literally means God breathed. Theo meaning God, nestes meaning breath, and it's God breathed. The breath of God, that's the inspiration. Now, if we were to pronounce it like it's written, we'd go canestis. It's kind of a word kind of like pneumatic or pneumonia. We don't say poo pneumonia. We don't say, you know, and that's the way it is with canestis, we would say. It actually has to do with breath and has broken it down with God breathed in NIV, which is correct every once in a while. So what he is saying is that the inspiration theonestis is the breath of God. And you know, it's like what you're hearing right now is the breath of Daniel. I'm speaking, and my lungs have air in my diaphragm. My rib cage is forcing the lungs to expel the air. Air is coming out over my throat and my larynx, and it's causing my vocal cords to vibrate, and my tongue and my teeth and my lips are making sounds. And what you are hearing right now is the breath of Daniel, an exhale of words. And the Bible says on your outline, all scripture is the breath of God. Amen. And it is God-breathed. Now listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 4:4. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Isn't that interesting? He is talking about the Bible. Every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. This is our owner's mouth. This is our instruction booklet. And ultimately, it is not simply that God breathed into the scriptures, but it's that God breathed the scriptures out. Oh, yes, he used human pen, man. He used Isaiah and Jeremiah, and he used Matthew, and he used Paul and Mark, and all these pen men for God. And these men were the voice of God as God was speaking. Holy men of God as they were moved. And the Bible says, by the Holy Ghost. Therefore, the Bible is true because God of truth cannot speak error. God cannot lie. Amen. He cannot lie. Listen, if you pick up the Old Testament, you'll find the phrases like the word of the Lord, or the word of God, or God spake, or the Lord said. And I tell you, that phrase is 3,808 times. That God said, or the word of the Lord came to me. Thus saith the Lord. That's 3,808 times. And I'm telling you, if the Bible is not the very word of God, it is the biggest bundle of lies that ever came to planet Earth. But it is true. And the Spirit testifies to the truth. So listen to what I'm saying. The Bible is a timeless book. The Bible is a truthful book. But the Bible, therefore, on your outline, should be a treasured book. Look, if you will, the law of thy mouth is better unto me than thousands of gold and silver. Look what it says in verse 72 of the thing. The law of the mouth is better than those thousands of gold and silver. We sing that song, more precious than silver. Well, is it really true for you? Well, listen, God is listening to me right now. God knows it's the absolute truth for me, but if you were to pile up gold and silver and rubies and bonds and stocks that went all the way to the ceiling, and over here on the other side, you had the Word of God, and you said you can have one or the other, and you can't have both, I tell you, there would be no hesitation. I would choose this book, the Word of God, because my ticket for abundant and eternal life is in the Word of God. I would have to even think about it for a minute because I know the importance. I used to have more things, and when I finally got the Lord, I finally got joy. And I like joy better than things. Big time. Look what it says in verses 103 in Psalms. It says, how sweet are thy words unto my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Sweeter than honey to my mouth. Let's look at 127. It says, therefore I love thy commandments above gold, yea, above fine gold. One version says above the finest or purest gold. So again, we see it is to be a treasured book. Now we know that the saints and the heroes have pillared their head on the word of God as they walk through the rivers, or the waters of the rivers of death, rather. And just think about the martyrs that have died for the witness of Jesus Christ that held the Bible to their bosoms as the creeping flames would come around their feet. Oh, the early church, I tell you, knew it was the Word of God. They never questioned it. They argued very little about it. We have so many different versions of things, it's just unbelievable because it's just not the true Word of God. There's so many religions that have a book to go along with the Bible to figure it out. We don't need another book. They preached it. They proclaimed it back then. They pronounced it. They poured it forth like white-hot lava. They loved it. They lived it. They practiced it. They trusted it. They obeyed it. And listen, they only had the Old Testament. They never even had the New Testament during that time. But they knew that the New Covenant didn't change any laws. It just fulfilled them. Like, there's no more sacrifice because of Jesus. They had to sacrifice every time they sinned, but when Jesus came, that was over. And now the Gentiles were sent the gospel. Gentiles are the non-Jews. That's why we got the gospel. And now, the only of the Ten Commandments that's not mentioned in the New Testament is what day we worship on. But now we can worship on any day of the week because God would prefer that we worship every day of the week instead of just one. And they claimed it constantly back then. And do you know why the Bible is treasured? It's because of this. It's on your outline. And you've known it for a long time. It's because Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. We need to treasure it. Listen, how will you ever, you'll never have a victorious Christian life if you do not love this book. You must love it. It is to be treasured. And I mean, suppose there was a treasure buried in your backyard. I tell you, you'd go right down to the hardware store and get a spade if you didn't have one. Listen, people, I'm telling you that this is a treasured book and you need to dig into it. And you'll find more joy than you will with money. So it is a timeless book. It is a truthful book. It is a treasured book. Now, the first point that you must remember is appreciate the virtues of the Word of God, because if you don't, you're not going to have any desire to understand it. But here's the second thing. Not only must you appreciate the virtues of the Word of God, but you must, number two on your outline, assimilate the vitalities of the Word of God. Assimilate is to make like, on your outline, resemble. Now, I chose the word vitality on purpose because the word vitality on your outline means alive. It means alive. Now, listen, the Bible is a living book, and we need to assimilate the life of the Word of God. Listen to what it is. Listen to what our theme was. It was Hebrews 4:12, and it goes like this. Hebrews 4:12 says, God, Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow. And this is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. I'll tell you, the Bible reads you. You find out about you when you look at that word. It says quick and powerful. Now the word quick on your outline means alive. NIV says living and active. Living and active, or quick and powerful. In Greek, it is zoon and energize. Zoon is a word that we get our word zoo from. Zoology, the study of animal life. It's zoon. Now, energize is the word we get our word energy from. So it's living and it's energetic. Now, Jesus in John 6 was speaking to some believers, and he said to them and to his disciples, he said this in John 6:63. He said, it is the spirit that quickeneth, that makes alive. The flesh profiteth nothing. You can do nothing in your flesh. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. You see, the Bible is vital. The Bible pulsates with life. And that's why I'm not only saying you have to appreciate it, but you must assimilate it. You must digest it and make like. It's like this. You don't just read the cookbook. You use the cookbook. And when you eat the meal, you've assimilated it. You've done what it says. So it's your owner's manual is the Bible. Now, if you don't assimilate it, no matter how much you appreciate it, what good is it going to do you? How do you assimilate the Word of God? Now, I'm going to give it to you right now, and it starts with this on your outline, number one. Pray over it. Pray over it. In Psalm 119, verse 12, blessed art thou, O Lord. Teach me thy statutes. Have you ever prayed, Lord God, please be my teacher? So do it. Pray over it and ask God to teach you. Now, if you pray over it, what will happen? On your outline, your eyes will be opened. Let's look at what it says in Psalm 119, verse 18. Open thou mine eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. God will open your eyes. You see, there are scales over your eyes right now, and God takes those scales off with prayer. And you need to read this book. I mean, you may have 20/20 vision, but God has to open your eyes to behold the wondrous things of his law. And it's like this. Do you remember in Luke 24 when they're after the resurrection and Jesus was walking with the two disciples on the road to Emmaus? And the Bible says that he began to talk with them about the Old Testament and the law and the prophets. And here's what it said in Luke 24, 45. Then he opened their minds so that they might understand the scriptures. Tell me, wouldn't you like God to open your mind so you could understand? I'll tell you that some of the greatest joys that I had is when all of a sudden I've understood something that I've been wondering and something comes across. I can't get over it. I have to go back and look at it again. But first, I'm telling you, you know, you need to pray over it before your eyes will be open. But then the next thing you do, so your heart will be, on your outline, stirred. You need your heart stirred. You need to be shaken up a little bit here. And stir, you know, we stir up a hunger for the Lord. We sing that song all the time. Look what it says in verse 36. It says, incline my heart unto thy testimonies and not to covetousness. So he's saying, Lord, change my heart and not to covetousness. I mean, don't change my heart into now I'm wanting these things. No, change my heart to want to know you. And you know, if you have the desire for the Word of God, you should pray this. God, please incline my heart, move my heart, open my eyes and stir my heart. And I tell you then, folks, when your eyes are open and your heart is stirred, on your outline, your mind is going to be enlightened. So often people tell me that they read the Bible, but they don't really pray before they do it. They don't really know where they're starting when they're reading, and they don't really know how to get going, and sometimes it kind of handicaps them. Look what it says in 73, verse 73, it says this. Thy hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn thy commandments. Your hands have made me, so give me understanding to learn your commandments. So I might grow. And it's so important to grow because that's where joy comes. And you know how often in sermon preparation I put my pencil down and prayed and bowed my head and said, God, please, help me to understand this. Give me some understanding. And all of this is under the heading of that we must pray over it. We've got to pray over it. And when we pray, our eyes are opened and our heart is moved and our mind becomes enlightened and stuff because we can then understand the Word of God. Now remember, we're talking about how to assimilate it. So again, number one, you pray over it. And then number two, on your outline, you ponder it. You ponder it. It says in Psalm 119, verse 15, and have respect, I will meditate in your precepts and have respect unto thy ways. You know, precepts is principles. The principles is what they are. Look what it says in 119, 147. It says this. It says, I prevented the dawning of the morning and cried, I hoped in thy word. So I start off with hope in your word. And I'm applying it to the day. And that's what you should do. You should start off with hope in the Word and applying it to the day. And what he's saying is that I got up early this morning and I trusted in your Word. And you know what it really means? It means I got up this morning and I had a little quiet time before I started. That's what it means. That is so important. And God will guide you through the day. So often we start and the first time we pray is when we all of a sudden hit an obstacle. Oh no, what am I going to do about that? God. And it's like you're supposed to start off with him and he will guide your footsteps then. And then it says in Psalm 119, 148, it says, mine eyes prevent the night watches that I might meditate in thy word. So he's saying my eyes stay open at night that I might meditate on your promises. Did you know when you know the promises of the Lord, that is security? And that you are to find out your problem and find out a promise for you so you can go ahead and help your situation? So you see, it takes time. You have to rise up an hour early to do it. If you have to stay up an hour late, do it. But you ought to always study with a pen in your hand. Did you know that if you don't get ready to write it down, what it tells me, that you're not expecting really to receive anything? And if you're expecting to receive something, you'd get ready to write it down because if you're going to be so excited about it, it's something that you'd want to remember. But you say, oh, I'll remember it. Yeah, right. I hope you do. But listen, the weakest ink is better than the best memory. I know. So you should get a pad when you open the Bible and then pray and then ponder it. And then you can get ready and let God speak to you. And then you've got to write it down like Jeremiah. Jeremiah goes, it's too much. I can't write it down. He says, write it down. I'll help you. I'll even give you a friend to help you. Now, when you read the Bible, use your sanctified common sense. That's one thing that we're lacking of in the world today. Don't just jump into the middle of a chapter, in the middle of the book somewhere with no plan, no rhyme, no reason. You see, the Bible is like any other book. It has all kinds of forms of speech. You see, poetry, you have to see poetry as poetry. You have to keep it in context. You have to see Proverbs as Proverbs. For example, if you try to turn a proverb into a promise, you'll lose your religion. Because the proverbs are not promises, they're proverbs. Well, what's a proverb? A proverb is a general principle, generally applied, that brings a general result. That's what proverbs are. For example, in the proverbs, there's ways to make you healthy, wealthy, and wise, and you can do all those things and then get hit by a truck. And then what do you got? You're not very wealthy anymore. You left it all. You're certainly not very healthy. You're dead. And obviously, you weren't too wise. Otherwise, you would have looked both ways. What I'm trying to say is this, a proverb is good, but don't try to turn a proverb, which is just a principle, into a promise. You need to look at the Bible and look at it and say, is this a precept, which is a principle? Is this prophecy? Is this poetry? Is this prose, the everyday speech? Is it proverbs? Is it a promise? But God, you know, God gave us a good mind, but God is not going to zap you with knowledge. You're going to go, oh, I want to know you, Lord, and boom, I got this knowledge. No, it don't work like that. You got to work for it. In fact, I'll have to work for it right to the day I die. And the most smartest scholars that I've ever known were working for it right to the day they die. He gives us enough information there that it never gets old, and we'll never have it all figured out till we get there. But the more you grow, the more you have love in your heart, the more you have joy in your life, and the more you have a spring in your step, because you know where you came from, you know what you're doing, and you know where you're going. And that's the important thing about having the Bible in your mind. You have the mind of Christ once you're saved, and then you must use your mind to study the Bible, but then you need to ponder the Bible. You must wait on the Lord. So often we're trying to get answers without waiting on Him. And sometimes most of our prayers are just us talking, us talking, us talking. Well, I'm done. Nobody's waiting for the Lord to talk to them. And some people say, well, is the Bible interpreted literally or figuratively? And you've probably heard that. Do you want to know the answer? The answer is yeah. It's interpreted figuratively and literally all at the same time. For example, the Bible is full of symbols. And here's one in the book of Revelation. The devil is symbolized as a dragon, a huge dragon. He has a tail so long that he sweeps a third of the stars out of heaven. Wow, think with me. Have you read lately about the new worlds that they discovered on the Hubble telescope? I mean, we know that there's billions of light years out there. Now tell me, is there a dragon with a tail long enough to sweep down one third of all the stars in heaven some billion light years away? And the smallest star is way bigger than the Earth. And that's a pretty big dragon. Now listen, he's talking about the devil called the dragon. And the stars are fallen angels that fell out of heaven. That's a completely different sermon. One third of the angels. But that is the symbolism, because the Bible is full of symbolism. So first you find out what the symbol stands for. And sometimes you might have to ask somebody. But then you literally believe. You don't say, well, there's just symbolism, so there's no devil. Oh, no, no, no. That's symbolism, and there is a devil. Now, it's like this. The yellow arch is at McDonald's ass. My grandkids know that that's McDonald's. When they see those arches, they know it's a McDonald's symbol. And when you see those yellow arches and you say, well, that's just a symbol of McDonald's restaurants. But do you think they only want to go see a symbol? No, they're thinking hamburgers. And you wouldn't say that's just a symbol when you find out what the symbol really stands for. And then you literally apply it. And you may have to ask somebody what some of the symbols mean so you can adjust your thinking in there. It's like the fish on the back of the car that stands for Christians. When you see that fish, I know, oh, it's probably Christian in that car. You know, and so what I'm trying to say once more is that you get a word of God, and then you pray over it, and then you ponder it, and ask God to teach you. Talk to Him like a teacher. Now, I want to give you 6 questions as you ponder, and get ready for you note takers and stuff to take, and make your Bibles come alive. They're going to go bang, 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 these 6 things. If you do these 6 things, it will benefit you in your Christian life. Number 1, is there a promise to claim? A promise. And when you're looking at a passage, is there a promise to claim? Number two, is there a lesson to learn? A lesson to learn. Okay, number three, is there a blessing to enjoy? What's the good thing out of it? A blessing to enjoy. Number four, is there a command to obey? A command to obey in. And number five, is there a sin to avoid? Is there a sin to avoid? And number six, is there a new thought to carry with me? Now, if you are preparing a Sunday school lesson, get any passage, and just look at it. And if you ask those questions, you have got your lesson. You do, and I promise, just those six simple questions. And you can learn so much about a passage if you ask yourself those questions. You need to look at the Word of God and pray over it and say, open my eyes. And you say, dear Lord, move my heart. And you say, dear God, give me understanding. And you look at the Word of God and you ponder it and you think about it. And you get a pen and you write these things down and you read it through and you think it clear. And you write it down, you pray it in, and then you live it out, and then you pass it on, and then it's yours. Get ready for a blessing. Well, you say, I can't remember all that. Well, you'll have to get the tape or get the DVD or write it down or get the outline or something, but we got to move on. So number one, pray over it. Number two, you ponder it. Number three on your outline, you preserve it. You preserve it. Look what it says in 119 verse 11. It says this here. Thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. I've hid your word in my heart to keep me strong and make me aware, to keep me from sinning. Look what it says in verse 16. I will delight myself in thy statutes. I will not forget thy word. Okay, I will not forget thy word. Statutes are written laws. Now, precepts are principles, and statutes are written laws. Okay, I'll delight in your laws. He's saying, I will not forget thy word. That means that you preserve it and you hide it down in your heart. No, I want to say that you can remember far more than you think that you can remember. Listen, don't tell me you can't remember, because you couldn't function if you couldn't remember things. We function by memory. And memory comes from concentration, and memory comes from motivation. When you think it's important, you remember. And also memory comes with use. Practicing it makes your memory better. And remember, your mind is a marvel, and you can remember far more than you think. So remember that as you preserve the Word of God in your heart. You know, it makes me think of how women like to go shop, and they like to buy those pretty little boxes. My wife likes those little pretty boxes, and sometimes they have beautiful designs on them and stuff, and they've got jewels on the outside of them, and you've seen those little boxes, and women have lots of them sitting around, and when you see that little box, you go, wow, that's a marvelous little box and everything, and then you look inside, and you know what's inside? It's usually some rubber bands or gem clips or toothpicks or an old breath mint or something in this beautiful little box. Well, I want to say your mind is like that box. You've got a marvelous mind, but you got all this junk in it. Unless it's completely full of the Word of God, is it? What a marvel God gave us when he gave us a mind. Now listen, you can't meditate on the Word of God unless the Word of God is there in your mind. You know, your mind is like a garden. You know, have you ever noticed how much easier it is to grow weeds than it is to grow flowers and vegetables? You know, when Adam fell, his mind became a garden of weeds. Boom! Immediately he was afraid, and his mind started filling in with doubt all over the place. Now, in order for your mind to preserve the Word of God, you've got to cultivate your mind. And it's just like you have to continually weed your garden. You have to continually get the junk out of it. It's just like your room. It's just like your kitchen. You continually get the junk out of it. You see, not only do you preserve it, but here's the fourth thing that you must do on your outline. You must practice it. You have to practice it. Look what it says in Psalm 119, 1 through 5. Listen to this. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with a whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. Thou hast commanded us to keep thy precepts diligently, his principles diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep thy statutes. That's his written law. My ways were directed to keep thy statutes. You know something? So many people don't even know what the statutes are. They don't know what precepts or statutes. They don't know what they're supposed to obey. Bible's a good book. There's good things in there. Hold the Bible up. It's good. But you don't know. You don't understand. It's not enough to recite the promises without obeying the back commandments, though. But here's a simple secret. Do you want to learn more about the Word of God? Do you need to have Him work in your life a little bit? Do you need to have more of Him? Then you've got to obey the parts you do know. It's so simple. The Bible says, to him the half shall be given. The rich get richer. The more you obey it, and the more you learn it and keep the Word of God, the richer you get in spirit. Remember, you have to do something with it. You say, well, there's a lot of the Bible I just don't seem to understand. Well, you know, I want to tell you something. You know, Mark Twain was reported to have said, who is not a believer, he wasn't a believer, and this is what he said. It's not the part of the Bible that I don't understand that gives me so much trouble. It's the part that I do understand. And that's what happens with non-believers. Those parts that you don't understand can cut like a knife. They can kind of wreck your lifestyle. You need to know the Bible. And it's not the part of the Bible I don't understand that gives me so much trouble. It's the part I do understand. You see, listen, there may be many mysteries and things that you don't understand, maybe on the third toe of some left foot of some beast in Revelation, but you can understand the Bible when it says to love God, study His Word, and to love one another. You can understand when the Bible gives you a clear commandment. And if you will begin to keep the Word of God, it will become real to you. The more you obey it, the more He really becomes to you. And the more you feel like wanting to see Him when you go there because you've been doing something about it. You're making treasures in heaven because you're furthering the kingdom by trying to advance yourself and learn about Him. Now, next on your outline, number 5, you must proclaim it. If you believe it, you better say it. This is the 5th of these things that you're going to do, and that is if you're going to assimilate it. Look what it says in verse 13 of 119. It says, with my lips have I declared all the judgments of thy mouth. That means if you believe it, you should tell everybody. With my lips I'm speaking. Psalm 119:27, read with me. Make me to understand the way of your precepts, so I talk of thy wondrous works. Did you know that in 3:16 of Malachi, it says that God is making a book of the people that like to talk about the Lord? A book of remembrance for the people that like to talk about the Lord. Look what it says in 119:46. It says, I will speak of thy testimonies also before kings, and I will not be ashamed. Look what it says in 119:172. It says, my tongue shall speak of thy word. It really says, sing of thy word. For all the commandments are righteous. So what we need to understand is that we need to get away from a lot of the things of the world and let the Word of God, on your outline, be in your mouth. And show it or stow it in your heart. Stow it in your heart. And show it in your life. If I saw you, would I see Jesus? And then you need to sow it in the world. Let somebody know where you stand. The more of the Word of God you give away, the more of it on your outline will stick to you. And what I'm saying is that if you really want to learn something, this is what helped me. I wanted to learn something so bad, and I really wasn't able to learn it the way I wanted to learn until I started teaching it. And when I started teaching it, then I started to learn it better. If you want to learn something, teach it. And what we said was this. Number 1, appreciate the virtues of the Word of God. Number 2, assimilate the vitalities of the Word of God. And so it's then that you can, number 3, appropriate the values of the Word of God. So that is, with this knowledge you have, there is going to come, on your outline, a transformation in your life. And it will be, number 1, a source of, on your outline, victory. That's what we want God in our life. But we want victory. We don't want to just know about God. We want Him to do something. We want our life changed. We want to grow. We want to know. We want to have joy. And He's saying, if you seek my precepts, my principles, you will overcome in freedom and in liberty. And I will walk at liberty, for I seek thy precepts, it says in 45. And it will also be a source on your outline of growth. This is what we want to grow. I mean, this seems like a complicated sermon and everything, but it's like basic stuff. If you want to learn about anything else in the Bible, you need to learn that the Bible is the inherent word, and it is truth. And when you get filled in with this truth, it will give you understanding for the things you do want to know. Look what it says in verse 119:32. I will run the way of the commandments when thou shalt enlarge my heart. We were talking about that. He gives us strength to run to opportunities. He gives us power to fly over situations and stuff. We were talking about that. And you know, I often think of the illustration when I think about people and reading the Bible and wanting to grow. I think about, they say, oh, come across someone, they say, I'm weak in my physical life. I can hardly get out of bed. I don't want to go to work. I'm so weak. Hey, what's the matter? You been to a doctor? No. Do you have a disease or something? I don't think so. Well, good Lord, what have you been eating and stuff? Well, I go eat on Sundays, a meal there, and that's all I eat once a week. And you mean that's all you eat, is one meal on Sunday? Yeah. You know, everything that I'm saying is just to whet your appetite. You're not going to get anywhere if you leave here and go, well, I had a sermon. You've got to go home and apply it. You've got to start every morning now and get your Bibles open and make a quiet time. You need to take a time where you take a few moments out and get your answer and find that promise for your situation and spend some time with God. And when you're done doing it all, it might seem hard, but you're going to have a relationship with Him. And that's what's so important. He says, spend some time with me. Spend some time with me. Everything that I'm saying was just to whet your appetite, to make you hungry. And if you would learn how to feed yourself on the Word of God, you're going to grow. And there you're going to go, you go forward. You're not going forward, you're going to go backwards. I've said that so many times. It's like being in a river. And if you don't go forward and you're just standing still, you are going backwards. And I'll tell you, going to church might keep you from going backwards too far, but living for the Lord is what takes you upstream. Being a follower and being committed. The Bible says, as newborn babes desire sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. Well, what we're trying to do here on Sundays, if when you come down here, is to get you to grow. Not get you to hear something that feels pretty good where you don't have to think about God all week and then come back to it. No, if I do that, I fail. Now also, on your outline, it is a source of joy. Wherever I am, it's my song. Look what it says in verse 54. Thy statutes have been my songs in the house of my pilgrimage. Also, it's a source of security. Look what it says in verses in 111. It says, thy testimonies have I taken as a heritage forever, for they are the rejoicing of my heart. Praise the Lord. So the word of God also, we said, was quick and powerful with strength. That kind of says that in verse 28. My soul melted for heaviness. Strengthen thou me according to thy word. You can say that. Strengthen thou me according to your word. And God will do it. He will do it. So it's a source also of guidance on your outline and understanding. Remember, like in 105, it also says, look what it says in 104. It says, through thy precepts, I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way. I love that. Anyway, so 105 says, it's a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Oh, what a wonderful thing. The word of God will give you all of these things. And I'm saying, do you want joy? Do you want all these things? Do you want power? Do you want victory? Do you want to overcome your problems? Do you want to find solutions for the problem you're in? Do you want to know the way that you should go? Do you want to know? You can only assimilate them, though, if you appreciate them. You have to appropriate them, and you can only appropriate them unless you assimilate them. And so, you see, I'm promising you that if you'll do that, it will be transformational in your life. Now, I'm going to sum up the Bible for those who are not really Christians. And maybe you've never really been saved, but can I go ahead and just give you the Bible in shorthand? The Bible addresses one problem. The problem is sin in our life. The Bible has one villain, and the villain is the devil. The Bible has one hero, and his name is Jesus. And the Bible has one purpose, that is to glorify God. Glorify God. That was what will further the kingdom. But here's the question. Do you know Jesus? Do you know him really? You see, this book is a two-edged sword. It will cut to heal you on your outline, and it will cut to slay you. And it is a savor of life unto life on your outline. because, or death unto death. Jesus came to divide. He did come to divide those who will build on him and those who don't. He will separate families and he will separate them because he wants you to build on him. And if you both build on him, he'll put you both together like a triangle. And you have a Jesus at the top and we're both on the sides. And the closer you get to him, the closer you get together. And that's how God works. And I'm promising you, you'll have a transformation in your life. So here's the thing. God wants me to tell you something today that comes right out of this book. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that's whosoever, that means anybody, that means anybody that believes him and puts their faith and their trust in him will not perish. They will not die. They will not go to hell. They will not, and they will have everlasting life. So tell me, do you know Jesus? And if you do know Jesus, trust in him. Search him for all the answers. Get to spend some time in this book. Do you know him? Just pray, Lord Jesus, come into my heart today. Because that's how to have true victory. And it's by learning how you make your Bible come alive. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. And I know with what the world is going through today, one of the most important things that we can do, Lord, is to learn your word so we would have security and strength as we go through it. Lord, we need you. We need you in our life. We need you for our decision making, Lord. We need you for our comfort. We need you to go ahead and help us feel secure when things are all against us and things are hard. Lord, in the world right now, as things are chaotic and everything all around, everything, nothing is chaotic with you, Lord. You know everything that's going on and everything is under control. And all those who have submitted to you, Lord, have that confidence and faith and security, knowing that you will keep a hedge of protection around us like the hedge of Job. Lord, we are so thankful to have such an awesome Savior. We love you so much, Lord, and we just need you in our life. We just thank you so much for everything you're doing, Lord, and we just pray that you would guide us and guard us through this life. Thank you again and ask for all of these things. In your precious name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. My thing is so cluttered up here. I couldn't find my other button. And so I was trying to get my wife down there because we're going to sing our last song and let you go. Anyway, so it is so nice that you were able to come today. It was kind of a heavy sermon. Next week we're going to be talking a different thing altogether. We're going to be talking about what it means. What's God's plan for the man? And it's Father's Day next weekend. It's going to be a wonderful sermon. I think you're going to like it. We're going to be talking about things around in the area and things that are going on. But it's a good one. But I wanted to do this one about the Bible because I want people to read their Bibles and look at it every day and try to find things. Ask other people questions about what you need to know so you can find and start finding your way through the Bible. I want to see. Go ahead. Come on. We've already prayed. Yeah, my bells didn't work and stuff. So. One of those things. Anyway, we're going to sing a song right now. If we could stand together, we're going to go ahead and sing, We Will Glorify. Here we go, We Will Glorify. Somebody filled up my box down there so full I couldn't even see in there. Here we go. Who was it? Probably me. Here we go. It sure don't sound like a man's on there. Here we go.
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I am.
Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the
thank you so much for your word, and we thank you for all that have come, Lord, and I pray that since they're here, that you would just bless them really good, Lord, and give them comfort as they go through things. Help them to know that there's nothing that we can do about things other than hold you up, Lord, and pray. And Lord, we pray for comfort for all the saints, and I just pray, Lord, that you would just fill them up with a boldness so that they would say they love you and that they would tell others that you're important to them and that they would show others that church means something. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would just seek him with a whole heart for all your decisions and everything we do. And I thank you again for all who have come, and I pray that they would just grow in your word. And we thank you and ask for all of these things in your precious name we pray, in Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen.
Amen, everybody. Have a great day. Go with God. It's Father's Day next week. We have a powerful sermon next week. I hope you have a great week.